Hi guys, this is Deepti from dgTraining. So as we have discussed in the part 1 of introduction to .NET framework, we have seen there like what is the importance of .NET framework, like why it has been introduced, and basically what does a program and why do we write programs, how the programs are getting executed, what does the compiler do in a programming, what is the role of it, what happens when a compiler is compiling the code in the whatever the code we are writing. So in the part 1 we have said that .NET framework is a runtime environment for the .NET applications. That means without the .NET framework we cannot execute or we cannot run the .NET applications. So what makes the .NET framework do that? What does the .NET framework have so that it is able to give a runtime environment for the .NET applications? So now coming back to this, .NET framework has components. So basically .NET framework has two main components. They are CLR, which is called as Common Language Runtime, and the other one is assemblies or base class libraries. BCL we call them as base class libraries, or you can also call them as FCL, framework class libraries. Framework class libraries. So these are the two main components of .NET framework which are internally making the .NET framework give a runtime environment or to execute the .NET applications. So coming into depth of this components of .NET framework, we will now see how this CLR and assemblies together are making the .NET applications run. So coming back to the CLR, Common Language Runtime, a component of .NET framework, it has a properties. It has some properties. So its properties are CLS, Common Language System, CTS, Common Type System. The other one is Garbage Collector, which is well known as GC, and the other one is JIT, Just-in-Time Compiler. So let's see about each thing, what they are internally and how they are doing and what are their roles in running a .NET application. Mainly when we are talking about the Common Language Runtime, basically what this will do. So to understand, before we understand what the CLR will do, here we have to understand a small thing, that is about the execution of the program. So how generally or basically how a program gets executed. For example, here in this case, if we say take an example of a C language program execution, what is the process of, how a C language program gets executed? So for that, what we are doing here is, let's assume you have a source code here. When I'm talking about the source code here, that means the code which we have written, the C program which we have written, is called as a source code. Now that source code is getting converted into native code, and then the native code gets executed with the help of OS. So this is basically what happens when you execute a C program. So what happens here? source code is getting converted into native code, and then the native code is getting converted into the required output or whatever it is getting executed basically. So here now a question comes, why the source code need to be converted into the native code? Why basically source code need to be converted? What is the reason? Now the source code is in the high level language. That means the source code is in the high level language, which is not understandable by, which is not understandable by OS. So to make the OS understand it, we are converting it. Hence the source code is getting converted into low level language called as native code, called as the native code. Now once the native code is converted, now the OS can understand the native code and it is getting executed with the help of operating system. Now what in case of .NET application? So here let's see .NET program execution. Let's see .NET program execution. Now how basically a .NET code is executed? So for this I am going to take a screenshot. I'll be showing you a screenshot where you can easily understand the flow of .NET program execution. So let me take that. So this is the flow of .NET code execution or the .NET program execution. So see here, as we have said, the source code which we write is generally whatever the code we are writing, whether in the C sharp or the C, whatever the language code we are writing, that is generally called as a source code. Now the source code is getting compiled into some MSIL here. So the source code language compiler is compiling the code into the some MSIL. So for now let's forget about what is this MSIL, CL and metadata. We are just seeing the flow of code execution, generally what happens. So the source code, the language compiler, whatever the programming language you are writing, that program language compiler is compiling the code into the MSIL. Then that MSIL is getting converted into native code with the help of CLR and it is getting executed. In the future we'll come back to this .NET code execution into very much deep. So right now to understand just where the CLR is coming over here and what does the CLR is doing, so we have just seen the code execution. So it's generally what it is doing, source code is getting converted into MSIL and then the MSIL is converted into native code by the CLR, that means or with the help of CLR, and then the code is getting executed here. So coming back to the CLR, so CLR has a lot of responsibility to convert the code into some native code and run it. So that is the main purpose of CLR in the .NET framework. But CLR is not alone doing that. CLR is taking help of its own properties, its own four properties: CLS, CTS, garbage collector and then the JIT compiler. So let's understand each of them to know what generally or what actually happens within the CLR when a .NET application is getting executed. So coming back to the CLS, we said that CLS is a common language runtime. So common language runtime means what? As we said, .NET framework supports more than 61 programming languages. more than 61 programming languages. Now, .NET framework cannot understand all the 61 programming language rules. Like suppose say, to understand it very easily, let's take a general example. Let's suppose we all are working in a company. Now when you guys are working in a company, company is not following your own rules, but the company has some rules and we all as an employees have to follow those rules. Now company will not say, okay, employee A, your timing is this, you come according to your timing, you do the work and you go. And employee B, you come to this time, you go this time, you come into this project or like that. So a company cannot understand all the requirements or all the necessities of an employees, all the employees. So what the company is doing here, it is been structured some rules which will be flexible to all the employees. So this is the starting time of the company and this is the ending of the ending time, work ending time of the company. You guys have to come within this time and go away within this time. Do the project, do it in this way, do it in this way, do it in this way. So every employee has to follow that rules to work in that company. Even though you have your own rules, even though the company has its own rules, both the company and the employees are mutually coming under some rules, and those rules are commonly followed by all the employees in the company. So here if you take an exam, if you assume CLR as a company and all the programming languages as employees. Now what happens? Every programming language has their own language rules. Now all those language rules cannot be understandable by the CLR. Right? So what the CLR did is, it has created its own language rules. It has created its own language rules which are commonly understandable by all the programming languages. So you will be writing the C# code followed by the CLS rules. So this is what the CLS is, common language system. In the same way, common type system, like how you have a language rules for each and every language, in the same way here each and every programming language has again its own data type system. So CLR cannot understand all the programming languages data type system. So what it does, it has created its own data type system which is common to all the programming languages. Now let's say for example here in C#, if you want to create a integer variable, I'll just simply create int a. But in Visual Basic, if you want to create a integer variable, we have to do something as dim a as integer, something like this, right? So see here, in C#, this is also an integer variable. In VB, this is also an integer variable. But the variation, the way you are declaring those variables are completely different. See. And also, in C#, according to the C# data type system, integer means int. And according to the int VB language, integer means the complete integer keyword. So there is a lot of difference between these two languages. So now assume, in the 61 languages you may have lot of differences like this. So all these rules cannot be understandable by CTS. So what is, sorry, CLR. So what did the CLR do? Whatever the variables or whatever the data type you are following, there is a common data type. So here what? In CTS, that int variable becomes int 32. This is the CTS data type. Clear? So this is how generally the common language system and the common type system has come. So basically what, every programming languages are having their own programming rules and data type systems, and CLR cannot. Why does CLR need to understand those? Because CLR has to convert the source code into the native code, right? So CLR has to compulsory understand what has been written in the application or what has been written in your code. So to understand the code you have written in the CLR, that code may be of any language, that can be of Visual Basic, C Sharp, J Sharp, whatever, all the out of any 61 programming languages, any language that you will be writing, those language has to be understandable by CLR. So for that reason, what CLR has done, instead of understanding all the programming language rules and type systems, it has created its own rules and common type systems. So this is what about the CLS and the CTS. Now coming back to the garbage collector, this is one of the important or a very efficient or very necessary property of a CLR, which has to do so much in the .NET applications. So the responsibility of a garbage collector is responsible to provide automatic memory management. So garbage collector is responsible to provide the automatic memory management. Good, we have understood that garbage collector is responsible for memory management, but how and for what it is going to provide the memory management? Now going back to the CTS. CTS has been divided into two types again. Two types: value types and reference types. So value types are nothing but which stores the value, occupies memory in the stack. And coming back to the reference types, which stores the address of the value where it is stored. Occupies memory in the heap. So automatic memory management is not provided by CLR, and here automatic memory management is provided by CLR. I mean like CLR's garbage collector. Here also basically it's CLR's garbage collector in turn. So here this CTS, the common type system of the CLR, has been divided into two types. One is the value types and the other one is the reference types. Now what is the difference between these value types and reference types? Value types are stored in the, like they are been occupied, they occupy the memory in the stack. We generally know the data structure, the memory structure, stack, queue, heap, all these things. So basically value types are stored in stack. Directly it stores the value. When you say int a equal to 10, directly that a equal to 10 has been stored into the memory location. And there is no automatic memory management for this value types. Now coming to this reference types, they store the address or the memory location of the value where it is stored. You can say here address, we mean that memory location. So memory location of the value where it is stored. So that is what we mean as the address. So it stores, rather it's directly storing the value, it do not store the value, but rather it stores the location or the memory or the address of the value where it is stored. So there is a difference. Value types directly stores the value, and reference types, they store the address of the value where it is stored. Right? So occupies memory in the stack and occupies memory in the heap. Now, automatic memory management is not provided to the value types, whereas automatic memory management is provided to the reference types compulsory. So this is what the CTS, value types and reference types. So generally when we talk about them, we have to talk about a small things called as boxing and unboxing. So basically, boxing means converting the value type into reference type, and unboxing means converting the reference type into value type. Depending on the scenario you're working in, the application may sometimes require to do this. We may change the value type into reference or reference into the value type. At that time we do this boxing and unboxing process. So this is what about the CLS and CTS and the types of value types and reference types of CTS. Now coming back to the garbage collector, as we said, garbage collector is responsible to provide the automatic memory management. So how is that able to do? So here I am calling it as GC. So whenever we say GC, that means it's a garbage collector. So GC performs an action onto the objects called as collection or collect, whatever it is, collection, identifies all the active and inactive objects. So what does it do? GC performs an action which is like called as collect or collection, identifies all the active and inactive objects, then all the inactive or idle objects will be removed from the memory to free the memory, and active objects will remain in the memory. So what it is doing generally? So it is performing an action called collection, identifying all the active and inactive objects. Once the inactive objects are found, it will be destroying them from the memory, and the active objects will remain in the same. So everybody knows this basically, what the garbage collector will do, how that what does it do? Collection, it will do a collection of all the active and inactive objects, it will put all the active objects into the memory, and then it destroys all the inactive objects from the memory. So this is all fine, but we have to know, like, this is very important for the people who will be preparing for their Microsoft certification exams, a level 1 exams like that. So the very introduction, .NET framework exam will be there, in which you will be asked about the performance of garbage collector, or what is the work of garbage collector, or the questions will be like generations of garbage collector. What happens within the garbage collector? Like we are saying, it is identifying the active and inactive, it is freeing up the memory. But how is that happening? So we need to understand that. So that's all for today, guys. In the next session, we will come up with the garbage collector, how basically it is going to work, and the remaining class .NET framework, class libraries and all. So that's all for today. We'll meet you in the next session. Bye guys, signing off.